The memory is a funny thing. It's living, breathing, changing. Less of a precise archivist and more of a fanciful storyteller. It can change events based on the passage of time, our biases, and our egos. All of which seem to come into play when attempting to document the life and final hours of Charles Arthur Floyd, better known to the world as the notorious murderer, bank robber, and public enemy number one, Pretty Boy Floyd. Thankfully, there are some things we know for sure about Floyd. He was born on February 3rd, 1904 in Bartow County, Georgia. He spent his youth growing up in Oklahoma and eventually performing agricultural odd jobs to help his father, a tenant farmer, make ends meet. This life of poverty was one Floyd knew he didn't want to live. Combine that with the glorification and exploits of several infamous outlaws, and not only did Floyd have a life he didn't want to live, he saw a way out. By 18, he was botching his first robbery of a local post office for a haul of only $3.50 in coin. By 21, he robbed a payroll intended for a Kroger grocery and baking of over $11,000. He'd be caught for the crime, and some authorities say that he was identified by a witness. The description given to police? Pretty boy. This is where details of Floyd's life begin to diverge. Fantasy and reality intertwining into a nearly indiscernible tapestry of legend, fact, and myth. The nickname of Pretty Boy has at least half a dozen origin stories, and even the date of that payroll robbery differs from source to source. What we do know for a fact is that Floyd served a documented 3.5 year of his 5-year prison sentence for that crime in the Missouri State Penitentiary. And legend has it, he vowed never to go back behind bars. From there, Floyd began learning the ropes from real heavy hitters and began a spree of armed robbery and murder that would begin his nationwide infamy. Even members of law enforcement were not safe. April 23, 1931, Floyd's gang kills patrolman R.H. Kastner of Bowling Green, Ohio. April 22, 1931, Floyd shoots and kills ATF agent C. Burke. And April 7, 1932, Floyd shoots and kills former Sheriff Irv Kelly, who was waiting for Floyd in ambush. But despite this blatant disregard for law and a penchant for murdering public servants, locals in Oklahoma began calling him the Robin Hood of Cookson Hills. Reasonable theories state that these locals were helping Floyd remain on the lam and being well compensated for their efforts. This gave rise to rumors that Floyd was ripping up mortgages during his bank robberies and helping the little guy from the big money banks, a story that made Floyd a near hero in the midst of the Great Depression. Before long, newspapers were picking up stories that the murderer and bank robber was feeding more than a dozen poor families, buying Christmas presents for children, as well as financially assisting the elderly. Floyd even wrote to the governor of Oklahoma in a letter stating, "I have robbed no one but moneyed men." In this time frame of 1931 to 1932, Pretty Boy Floyd committed 12 bank robberies, the murders mentioned earlier, and was credited for countless others of each that he had no responsibility for. It wouldn't be long before the same misgiven credit that made him a folk hero also turned against him. Rightly or wrongly, Floyd became an instant suspect for an event that would come to be known as the Kansas City Massacre. 4 lawmen and a prisoner were killed in a hailstorm of bullets. Parties on both sides of the law proclaimed Floyd's innocence and guilt, and Floyd himself even wrote a postcard to the Kansas City police proclaiming his innocence. But the damage had been done, and it was all the excuse J. Edgar Hoover and the FBI needed to set the dogs loose. On the day that Floyd was killed, accounts vary wildly. All reliable accounts state that Floyd and his accomplice were traveling with their female companions in a heavy fog when their vehicle struck a telephone pole on October 20th, 1924. Before long, police arrive on the scene, a shootout begins, and Floyd escapes into the woods. On the lam for days, Floyd survived in the woods, eating fruit. But after 2 days, he stopped by a local farmhouse requesting food and looking quite disheveled. After paying her $1 for what he called a meal fit for a king, he requested a ride into town. His host couldn't give him a ride, but her brother could. And while still on the farmhouse property and just about to depart into town, 2 cars of lawmen showed up, and again, history becomes more of a storyteller than an archivist. The stories of the FBI, law enforcement, and eyewitnesses vary greatly. Local law enforcement story goes that a retired lawman and former World War I sniper Chester Smith shot Floyd twice non-lethally with a Winchester rifle to stop him, and that when Floyd got up again, the entire team of lawmen opened fire on Floyd. FBI accounts state that as Floyd was running across a cornfield, eight officers followed in hot pursuit, and as he turned either to shoot or to look back, he was fired upon. In later years, the story becomes muddled even further with tales of a point-blank execution with a Tommy gun, and who was even present at all. But one thing is for sure, the FBI requisitioned two Thompson machine guns from the East Liverpool Police Department to help bring in Dillinger. They are identified by serial number, and this is one of them. Did this Thompson kill one of the most notorious bank robbers of all time? Almost certainly. Was this Thompson machine gun unquestionably and unequivocally present at his death? Yes. This is an iconic American firearm used to halt the spree of an iconic American criminal, each a symbol of their era. A lot of details can change as decades pass. Men die, records are lost, and memories come and go like shadows and dust. Thankfully, when it comes to the capture and death of Pretty Boy Floyd, one thing stands concrete, documented, and certain, and it's this Tommy gun.